بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, I testify that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is Allah's true slave and messenger. May Allah's salah and salam be upon the Prophet Muhammad, his noble and pure family, and his noble companions and those who follow on their path until the day of resurrection. We continue the explanation of Surah Al-Kahf, and we have reached verse number 57. So this will be verse number 57. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا وَنَسِيَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَاهِ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقْرًا وَإِنْ تَدْعُهُمْ إِلَى الْهُدَى فَلَنْ يَهْتَدُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا. And who does more wrong than he who is reminded of the ayat of Allah, meaning being admonished by the ayat, the verses and the proofs and the evidences and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ayat of Allah are two types. One is called kawni, which means universal, and the other is shara'i, which means legal. These are the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his signs and his revelations pertain to two aspects. First one is universal, this is called kawni, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's universal decree of taking and eliminating the previous nations who belied, or his legal legislation like the Quran itself is from the verses or the ayat, the proofs and the evidences or the revelation, which is shar'iyya, pertaining to the sharia. The Quran is an example. Admonished and then does not accept it. So there is none who could be more, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, could do more wrong than this one. And this is like the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala earlier in the chapter, in the same surah, فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. And who does more wrong than the one who invents a lie against Allah? So how can we understand these verses? Here, for example, in this verse, and who does more wrong than he who is reminded? So, meaning from those who are reminded and turn away, who can do more wrong than he when he is reminded of the ayat of Allah, turns away? So a man could be admonished and turn away, but the greatest wrong then is to be reminded and admonished regarding the ayat of Allah, his verses, his revelations and proofs and everything. ثم يعرض عنها, then after that, and then he turns away from them. And also in terms of inventing lies, we know that a person can invent lies with respect to another person. However, the greatest wrong would be is to invent a lie against Allah. And again, the ayat of Allah are of two types, kawni, universal, and legal. For example, if someone is reminded concerning the universal signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is told that the eclipse of the sun and of the moon is a sign from Allah to install fear in the hearts of his slaves. Yet he turns away from that. And he says, the eclipse of the sun or of the moon is something natural. This is a natural phenomenon. And that there is no warning and nothing related to it. This is called turning away. This is called i'rab, turning away. And as to the turning away from the legal commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is too many to even to mention here. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, turning away from them, forgetting, وَنَسِيَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَهُ, forgetting what deeds his hands have sent forth, from disbelief, from sins, and from arrogance, and the like, which prevents him from accepting the truth. Because man, and we seek refuge in Allah from this, the more he submerges or indulges in sin, then the more he will be turning away from accepting the truth. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that in Surah As-Saff, chapter 61, verse 5, فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. So when they turned away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned their hearts away, meaning from accepting the right path from the truth. So when they turned away from the path of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned their hearts away from accepting the truth. And therefore from this we can learn that from the severest forms of punishment regarding sins, that man may be punished by the disease of the heart. We seek refuge in Allah from this. If man is punished by a form of, you know, losing someone he loves, or a wealth that he loves to accumulate, this is definitely a punishment. It could be, losing a beloved one as a form of punishment, yes. Losing something that he likes and loves as a form of punishment, yes. However, if he is punished by the detachment of the heart, then this punishment is the severest that it could afflict him. يقول الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله in a poetry, he said, والله ما خوف الذنوب فإنها, by Allah, I don't fear the sins, فإنها لعلى طريق العفو والغفران, by Allah it is on the path of forgiveness and pardoning. وإنما أخشى انسلاخ القلب من تحكيم هذا الوحي والقرآن. However, the most I fear is the detachment of the heart from تحكيم هذا الوحي والقرآن, from abiding to and turning to this revelation of Quran and to abide by it and by its commands and what it entails. This is the meaning of the poetry. والله ما خوف الذنوب فإنها لعلى طريق العفو والغفران إنما وإنما أخشى انسلاخ القلب من تحكيم هذا الوحي والقرآن. The most I fear is the detachment of the heart from taking this revelation and the Quran as a judge. This is indeed the thing which any sensible person really fears. As to the masa'ib al-ukhra, the other afflictions, فهي كفارات, it could be as expiations for sins. And it could turn, وربما تزيد العبد إيمانا, it may turn to increase the faith and iman and belief of the slave. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning those who turn away, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أكنة أن يفقهوه وفي آذانهم وقرا. Truly we have set veils over their hearts, أكنة على قلوبهم, veils over their hearts. As to those who turn away. Truly we have set veils over their hearts, lest they should understand, meaning this Quran and the verses of Allah and His signs. Not only that, this is from the understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala veils their hearts. وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقْرَى. So, as to their understanding of the Quran, they are not going to understand it. And in this verse here, in this verse, in this statement, in this verse, حَثٌ عَلَى فِقْهِ الْقُرْآنِ. We understand therefore from this the motivation that we should understand the Quran, and that the person who reads the Quran and understands what it means, then he would be like the, on the way of the companions. كما كان الصحابة, as the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with all of them, لا يتجاوزون عشر آيات حتى يتعلموها. They wouldn't exceed the reciting of 10 verses until they, you know, memorize it, and then يتعلموها, and know what it means, وما فيها من العلم والعمل, and what it comprises from knowledge and actions. And وفي آذانهم وقرا, and also not that, and in their ears deafness, veils over their hearts lest they should understand, and in their ears deafness, those who turn away. So the hearts covered, veiled, so it cannot understand. The ears deaf, so they can't listen. So they can't listen to the truth and they can't understand it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِن تَدْعُهُمْ إِلَى الْهُدَى, and if you call them to guidance, even then they will never be guided. So if you guide them by showing them the way to the truth, they are not going to be guided, as long as their hearts are covered and veiled, and their ears, and in their ears deafness, they are not going to be guided. So from where are they going to get the guidance if their hearts are sealed and veiled, and their ears, there is deafness? So the ears doesn't listen to the truth, and the heart does not submit to the truth. وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. We seek refuge in Allah from this. So if someone says, هَلْ فِي هَذَا تَيْئِيسٌ لِلرَّسُولِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مِنْ أَنَّهُ وَإِنْ دَعَى لَا يُقْبَلْ مِنْهُ أَوْ فِيهِ تَسْلِيَةٌ لَهُ. If someone now may ask the question, does this mean that this is like, you know, making the Prophet ﷺ hopeless regarding their belief? I mean, that's it. Or it is a form of comfort to him? Or is it a form of comfort? The answer is, in this there is comfort to the Prophet ﷺ. وَأَنَّهُمْ إِذَا لَمْ يَقْبَلُوا الْحَقَّ فَلَا عَلَيْكَ مِنْهُمْ. And if they are not going to accept the truth, then don't worry about them. Don't feel despaired. فَلَنْ يَهْتَدُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا. Verily, they are not going to be guided. Even then, they will never be guided. This brings the end of verse 57. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next verse says, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَفُورُ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ. وَرَبُّكَ الْغَفُورُ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ لَوْ يُؤَاخِذُهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا لَعَجَّلَ لَهُمُ الْعَذَابُ بَلْ لَهُمْ مَوْعِدٌ لَنْ يَجِدُوا مِنْ دُونِهِ مَوْئِلًا. And your Lord is most forgiving, the Rahmah, owner of mercy. لَوْ يُؤَاخِذُهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا. And this is comfort, another comfort to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, تَسْلِيَ لَهُ, from another angle. Because the Prophet ﷺ, you know, he might say, لماذا لم يعاجلوا بالعقوبة? Why they are not being, you know, earned the punishment, and hastened, the punishment is hastened for them. كيف يكذبونني? How come they belie me? وأنا رسول الله ولم يعاقبهم? And I am the messenger of Allah, yet he didn't hasten the punishment for them, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him to be comfortable regarding this and made it clear to him. أَنَّهُ Allah is the most forgiving. أَيْ الَّذِي يَسْتُرُ الذُّنُوبَ وَيَتَجَاوَزْ عَنْهَا. Most forgiving means Al-Ghafoor is the one who covers these sins and he pardons them. ذو الرحمة, صاحب الرحمة, owner of mercy, who is clement to his servant who sins. ولهذا قال, and that's why he said then, لو يؤاخذهم بما كسبوا, لو أراد الله, يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى, had he willed أن يؤاخذ الناس بما كسبوا, held to hold people to account for what they have earned, لعجل لهم العذاب, then surely he would have hastened their punishment. And this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear in Surah Fatir. Again, in Surah Fatir, he mentioned, which is Surah 35, verse 45, وَلَوْ يُؤَاخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِمَا كَسَبُوا مَا تَرَكَ عَلَى ظَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةِ وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِّرُهُمْ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. And if Allah were to punish men for what they have earned, he would not leave a moving living creature on the surface of the earth, but he gives them respite to an appointed term, and when their term comes, then verily Allah is over all seer of all his slaves. بَلْ لَهُمْ مَوْعِدٌ, then definitely, but they have an appointed time, لَنْ يَجِدُوا مِنْ دُونِهِ مَوْئِلًا, beyond which they will find no escape. So it means that they are not going to be saved from the punishment if the punishment is delayed to befall them, because they have an appointment, they have no place to run to, and this will be on the day of resurrection, وهذا يوم القيامة. And it could also mean, ويحتمل أن يكون ما يحصل للكفار من القتل على أيدي المؤمنين. And it also could mean this punishment could be in the form of the killing that may be inflicted on the kafirs on the hands of the believers, meaning in the battlefield. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in Surah At-Tawbah, chapter 9, verse 14 and 15. قاتلوهم 14 and 15, yes. قاتلوهم يعذبهم الله بأيديكم ويخزهم. Fight against them so that Allah will punish them by your hands. So this could be, you know, that they may take the punishment here. ويخزهم, and disgrace them and give you victory over them. وينصركم عليهم ويشفي صدور قوم مؤمنين, and give you victory over them and heal the breasts of a believing people. ويذهب غيظ قلوبهم, and remove the anger of their the believers' hearts. So it really could take both meaning, is that what's intended could refer to the punishment that may be inflicted upon them through the fighting which will occur with them, and this could take place in this life, or as to that which will befall them, and that is inevitable on the day of resurrection. So this brings the end of verse 58. We go to verse 59. وَتِلْكَ الْقُرَىٰ أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ لَمَّا ظَلَمُوا وَجَعَلْنَا لِمَهْلِكِهِمْ مَوْعِدًا. القرى, تلك القرى, and these towns, referring to the previous nations, the towns عاد and ثمود and others. So these, تلك القرى, and this denotes that what's intended by the towns, its people, its population. And also the towns, when they are mentioned in the Quran, they could also refer to the towns, meaning the house residences and which constitutes the town. So sometimes it could denote the people and these towns, Ad and Thamud. The inhabitants of these towns were destroyed when they did wrong, and we appointed a fixed time for their destruction. And also it could mean, you know, the town as a town, like in Surat, which are, you know, the residences as a whole, like in Surat Al-Ankabut 29 31, When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا مُهْلِكُوا أَهْلِ هَذِهِ الْقَرْيَةِ In 29:31. Okay. Now, verily we are going to destroy the people, أهل, of this town. So the town. Now here came, the أهل came before, the people came before, and then of this town, هذه القرية. And this, you know, refers to Al-Qarya here. It means Al-Masakin Al-Mujtami'ah, which constitutes the town, the houses which and the residences, which constitutes, makes up a city or a town. Now, and also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could refer to the Qura as to mean the inhabitants, the towns, the people. As in Surah Al-Qasas 28:59. القصص 28:59 وما كان ربك مهلك القرى حتى يبعث في أمها رسولا يتلو عليهم آياتنا وما كنا مهلك القرى إلا وأهلها ظالمون. And never will your Lord destroy the towns, here it means the populations, until he sends to their mother town a messenger reciting to them our verses. And never would we destroy the towns unless the people thereof are wrongdoers. So when and the wrongdoing here, it means in this verse in Surah 50 in Surah Al-Kahf, وَتِلْكَ الْقُرَىٰ أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ لَمَّا ظَلَمُوا. This ظلم, the wrongdoing here means the kufr, it means disbelief, meaning when they and these towns we destroyed them when they did wrong. And the wrong here means the حِينَ كَفَرُوا, when they disbelieved. وجعلنا لمهلكهم موعدا, and we appointed a fixed time for their destruction. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does what he wishes. If he wishes to hasten the punishment, he would do so. If he wishes to delay it, he would do so. However, in either case, when the time appointed comes, then it is gonna come without any delay. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قال نوح, and that's why Nuh alayhi salam said to his people in Surah Nuh 71:4, يغفر لكم من ذنوبكم ويؤخركم إلى أجل مسمى إن أجل الله إذا جاء لا يؤخر لو كنتم تعلمون. He, Allah, will forgive you of your sins and respite you to an appointed term. Verily the term of Allah when it comes cannot be delayed if you but knew. So it is a fixed time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, necessitated by His wisdom subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we go now to verse 60, and here begins the story of Musa and with Al-Khidr. The story of Musa with Al-Khidr. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. And remember when Musa told his boy servant, and his boy servant is Yusha bin Nun, his name is Yusha ibn Nun. And this has an origin to this story, came also in Sahih al-Bukhari. In the hadith reported by Ubay bin Ka'b, may Allah be pleased with him, that he heard Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Musa alayhi salam, Moses, got up to deliver a speech before the children of Israel. فقام أحدهم وقال هل على وجه الأرض أعلم منك. And he was asked, someone stood up from amongst them and asked him, and he was asked, who is the most learned person amongst the people? Musa replied, I am the most learned. So this is because of his pre-assumption, Musa عليه السلام, أنه لا أحد أعلم منه, that there is no one who is more knowledgeable than him. فعتب الله عليه في ذلك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he admonished him for that. For he did not ascribe knowledge to Allah alone. So Allah revealed to him, أَنَّ لِي عَبْدًا أَعْلَمُ مِنْكَ, that there is a slave who is more knowledgeable than you. At the junction of the two seas, there is a slave of ours who is more learned than you. And he gave him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inspired to Musa alayhi salam, gave him a mark. And he said, take a fish and put it in a basket. And then proceed. Set out, and where you lose the fish, you will find him. So he took the fish in a miktal, which is a large basket, and went with his, alaykum salam, with his boy, with servant boy Yusha bin Nun. So Musa took a fish and put it in this basket and set out along with his boy servant Yusha bin Nun. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying this in the hadith which is in Sahih al-Bukhari, till they reached, in order to see, you know, who is this person who is more knowledgeable than him, in order to learn from him. Till they reached a rock on which they both lay their heads and slept. As to this junction of the two seas, Allah knows best as to where it is exactly. And it is said that it is the junction between the Red Sea and the White Sea, which is the Mediterranean. And before, meaning before this canal was opened, which is the Suez Canal now, there was a land between both of them. And yani, this is as our Shaykh rahimahullah said in his explanation of the surah, he said, وَهَذَا لَيْسَ بِبَعِيدٍ, yani this is yani close to, not far from being the case, that it may be at this junction of the two seas, the Red Sea and the Mediterranean, the White Sea. So till they moved, Musa and his boy, his servant boy, Yusha bin Nun, till they reached a rock on which they both lay their heads and slept. The fish moved, moved vigorously in the basket and got out of it and fell into the sea. And there it took its way through the sea. Straight as in a tunnel. All of this is from Sahih al-Bukhari now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped the current of water on both sides of the way created by the fish, and saw that way was like a tunnel. So when they woke up, when Musa got up, his companion forgot to tell him about the fish. And so they carried on. And we know that the fish now took inside the sea and formed this tunnel shape movement by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Musa got up, his companion forgot to tell him about the fish, and so they carried on their journey till the rest of the day and the whole night. And this is from the ayat of Allah. This is from the any great signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that here the water, this fish falls in the sea and took its way through the sea in this form. Allah stopped the current of water on both sides, and this is an ayah. Allahu Akbar. هذا من آيات الله. These are from the ayat proof. Otherwise we know that if a fish moves in the sea, water will come from on it from all sides. And the sign here, from the signs of Allah, there are two signs here. First, this fish was dead, and that they were to eat from it. Then it became alive and entered the sea. And these are from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Musa got up, his companion forgot to tell him about the fish, and so they carried on their journey during the rest of the day and the whole of the night. And the next morning, Musa asked his boy servant, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in verse 62, فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَا. So when they had passed further on beyond that fixed place, which Allah revealed to Musa, Musa said to his boy, bring us our morning meal. Truly we have suffered much fatigue in this own journey. Look at this, in this our journey, in this is very important. So we passed the place. So here Musa, this fatigue that touched them, he is not referring to the journey from the beginning, from where they initiated the travel. وَلَكِن مِنْ حِينِ مَا فَارَقَا الصَّخْرَ. But from the point when they have left that rock where they slept. And that's why he ordered the meal. The scholars of Islam said, and this constitutes one of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they have traveled earlier a longer journey and nothing of fatigue touched them. However, when they bypassed the appointed place where Al-Khidr is, this knowledgeable man whom Allah spoke to him about him, they suffered fatigue. So that why? So that من أجل ألا يتماديا في البعد عن المكان, lest they go far beyond the fixed place. Subhanallah. La ilaha illallah. So Musa did not get tired till he had passed the place which Allah had ordered him to seek after. So his boy servant then said to him in verse 63, قَالَ أَرَأَيْتَ إِذْ أَوَيْنَا إِلَى الصَّخْرَةِ. Do you remember when we betook ourselves to the rock? فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ. There indeed I forgot the fish. But Shaitan made me forget to remember it. It took its course into the sea in a strange way. So he said, I indeed forgot the fish, meaning forgot to look at it and see what it needs and so forth. Otherwise, the fish was in the basket. They knew where it was. And it took its course into the sea in a strange way. He's expressing his amazement for what he saw from the sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Musa knew. So this was the tunnel for the fish, and for Musa and his boy swim there was astonishment. Musa said in 64 now, قَالَ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنَّا نَبْغِي. This is what we have been seeking. فَارْتَدَّا عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمَا قَصَصًا. So they went back retracing their footsteps. So they both returned retracing their footsteps till they reached the rock. And behold, the Prophet ﷺ said, there they found a man covered with a garment. فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا. Then they found one of our slaves. آتيناه رحمة من عندنا, and we unto him we had bestowed mercy from us, and whom we had taught knowledge from us, وعلمناه من لدنا علما. So there they found a man covered with the garment. Musa greeted him. Musa alayhi salam greeted him. And this man's name is Al-Khidr. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said Al-Khidr. Said Musa meaning Moses. Moses. Al-Khidr alayhi salam. Now Al-Khidr said astonishingly. He said, is there such a greeting in your land? Moses said, I am Musa, I am Moses. So Al-Khidr said, are you the Musa, the Moses of the children of Israel? Moses said, yes, and added, I have come to you so that you may teach me something of that knowledge which you have been taught. Now, so who is Al-Khidr? Allah described him as one of our righteous slaves. Is he from the awliya, the friends of Allah, whom Allah bestowed miracles upon, or is he an inspired prophet? All of that is possible. However, the text indicate that he is not a messenger nor that he is a prophet. إِنَّمَا هُوَ عَبْدٌ صَالِحٌ, that he is a righteous slave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him miracles. لِيُبَيِّنَ اللَّهُ بِذَلِكَ, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes clear that Musa alayhi salam, that Moses, لا يحيط بكل شيء علما, موسى عليه السلام does not encompass everything with his knowledge, وأنه يفوته من العلم شيء كثير, and that he misses a great deal of knowledge. Then Allah describes this slave Al-Khidr by saying, آتيناه رحمة من عندنا, آتيناه رحمة من عندنا, we have bestowed mercy upon him from us, وعلمناه من لدنا علما, meaning we have given him knowledge where others don't know of. وهو علم الغيب, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon him from the knowledge of the unseen. In this particular story, it is not a علم of nubuwa, it is not a knowledge of prophethood, ولكنه علم خاص, ولكنه, it's a specific knowledge, because this knowledge whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made available, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Al-Khidr, cannot be, لا يمكن إدراكه, can't be comprehended, and it is not based on something يعني محسوس, seen and physical. It is part of the unseen, some of the unseen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him knowledge where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he made it a special knowledge, لا يطلع عليها البشر, not known to mankind in this specific case. So Musa told him, قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رجدا. Musa told him, and this is a very important benefit here. قال هل أتبعك, وهذا عرض لطيف وتواضع. In a humble request he said, may I follow you, may I follow you so that you teach me something of that knowledge which you have been taught. تأمل هذا الأدب من موسى عليه الصلاة والسلام. Comprehend and try to think and contemplate this manner, this great manners of Musa alayhi salam, knowing that Musa أفضل منه, is better than him, better than Al-Khidr. وكان عند الله وجيها, and he was honored with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet يتلطف معه, yet he speaks to him kindly, Why? لأنه سوف يأخذ منه علما لا يعلمه موسى. Because he is going to acquire knowledge which from him which موسى does not know of. وفي هذا دليل. And in this there is evidence أن على طالب العلم that the seeker of knowledge أن يتلطف مع شيخه ومع أستاذه وأن يعامله بالإكرام. And this is evidence and proof that the seeker of knowledge, the student of knowledge should be kind with his sheikh and with his teacher and he should treat him with honor. Then ثم بين موسى that موسى is telling him that he is not, you know, after him to eat from his food or to drink from his drinks, ولكن على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا. This is the goal, that you teach me something of that knowledge which you have been taught. And there is no doubt that Al-Khidr will be pleased for someone to take knowledge from him. And وكل إنسان, and every man, أعطاه الله علما, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed knowledge upon him, ينبغي أن يفرح أن يؤخذ منه هذا العلم, should be pleased that this knowledge is taken from him, is delivered to others. لأن العلم الذي يؤخذ من الإنسان في حياته, it is because that the knowledge taken from a person in this life ينتفع به بعد وفاته, that he will benefit from it after his death, كما جاء في الحديث الصحيح, as reported in the authentic hadith where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said إذا مات الإنسان انقطع عمله إلا من ثلاث. When man dies, then his actions cease to stop, meaning to benefit from, except from three: صدقة جارية, continuous charity, أو علم ينتفع به, or knowledge that he may benefit from, أو ولد صالح يدعو له, أو ولد صالح يدعو له, or a righteous son who invokes Allah for him. So what was the response of Al-Khidr? Here Musa alayhi salam told him, you know, I have come to you so that you may teach me something of that knowledge which you have been taught. Al-Khidr said in verse 67, قال إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا, verily you will not be able to have patience with me. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, O Musa, the Khidr now saying, O Musa, I have some of Allah's knowledge which he has bestowed upon me, but you don't know it. And you too have some of Allah's knowledge which he has bestowed upon you, but I don't know it. So Musa, what did Musa say? He said, if Allah wills, you will find me patient and I will not disobey you in aught. If Allah will, you'll find me patient and will not disobey you. But Al-Khidr reminded him, and he knew, Al-Khidr, he knew because Allah informed him. You know, he was giving it in a question because he knew what's going to come, Al-Khidr. So he, in verse 68 before this, he said, وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ قَالَ إِنَّكَ لَمْ تَسْتَطِعَ مَعِيَ صَبْرًا. You're not going to be patient with me. وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. And how can you have patience about a thing which you know not? Where is the evidence here? Where is the evidence? أين الدليل؟ أين الدليل الخبر أن موسى لم يحط بذلك خبرا؟ Where is the evidence that موسى عليه السلام, you know, was not aware? The answer is, he said, Musa in the earlier verse, he said to him, عَلَىٰ أَن تُعَلِّمَنِي. You know, Musa, when he said to him, may I follow you so that you teach me something. And this tells, وَهَذَا يَدُلْ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ لَا عِلْمَ لَهُ فِي مَا عِنْدَ الْخَضْرِ, عِنْدَ الْخَضْرِ, that he doesn't know as to the knowledge which Al-Khidr had. So, ماذا قال له موسى عليه السلام in verse 69 which we put there? موسى said, if Allah will, قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. If Allah will, look at this condition. If Allah will, you will find me patient and I will not disobey you in aught. So Musa is telling him as to what he is convinced regarding himself. Meaning during that hour, during that moment, من أنه سيصبر, that he is going to be patient. Yet he linked it to the مشيئة. Yet he linked it to the مشيئة, which is if Allah wills. Why? لألا يكون ذلك, lest this become اعتزازا بنفسه وإعجابا بها. Lest this become as a matter of, you know, false pride in himself. Musa عليه السلام. And in his saying, and in his Musa saying, you will find me patient. ستجدني إن شاء الله. If Allah will, you will find me. This is like the saying of Ismail, of Ishmael, the son of Ibrahim. May Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم be upon both of them. لما قال له أبوه, when Ibrahim his father told him, إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك, as in Surah الصافات 37:102. إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك فانظر ماذا ترى قال يا أبت افعل ما تؤمر ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. And when he, his son, was old enough to walk with him, and he said, oh my son, I have seen in a dream that I am slaughtering you, offer you in sacrifice to Allah, so look what you think. He said, oh my father, do that which you are commanded, inshallah, if Allah will, this is the point of evidence, you shall find me of as-sabirin, the patient ones, etc. And here Musa told Al-Khidr, ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا, if Allah wills, you will find me also patient. أصبر على ما تفعل, I'll be patient concerning that which you will do. وأمتثل ما به تؤمر, and I will comply with that which you are commanded. ولا أعصي لك أمرا, I'm not disobey you not. So he promised him two things, patience and compliance. قال الخضر, in response الخضر told him, قال فإن اتبعتني, the next verse please, verse 70. Yes, he said, then if you follow me, فلا تسألني عن شيء, ask me not about anything, حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرى, until or till I myself mention it to you. And he told him, if you follow me, and he knows, Al-Khadr, he knows that he's going to follow him. فلا تسألني عن شيء, then ask me not about anything, which I will do, حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرى, this حتى here, until I tell you the reason. And this is, in this there is a point of benefit. This is a direction and education from a teacher to the one who is acquiring knowledge from him, that he should not hasten to respond to his teacher, بل ينتظر, but should wait, حتى يحدث له بذلك ذكرى, until he gives him a reason for that particular matter. وهذا من أداب المتعلم, and this is from the etiquette of the one seeking knowledge, أن لا يتعجل في الرد حتى يتبين الأمر, that he should not hasten into response until the matter is clear. So now they set on, verse 71, فانطلقا حتى إذا ركبا في السفينة خرقها قال أخرقتها لتغرق أهلها لقد جئت شيئا إمرا. So they both proceeded, they moved when they embarked the ship. So after that, both of them, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, proceeded along the sea coast till a ship passed by, and they requested the crew to let them go on board. The crew recognized Al-Khidr, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the crew recognized Al-Khidr and allowed them to get on board free of charge. When they got on board, suddenly Musa saw that Al-Khidr had pulled out one of the planks of the ship with an edge. He pulled one of the planks of the ship with an edge. Musa alayhi salam, Moses alayhi salam, said to him, I أخرقتها لتغرق أهلها؟ And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you know, he told him Musa, have you scuttled it in order to drown its people? Verily, you have committed a thing, imra, munkar, evil, bad, dreadful thing. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم now said that Musa said to the Khidr here, عليكم السلام, said to the Khidr, these people gave us a free lift, yet you have scuttled their ship so as to drown its people. Verily, you have committed a thing, munkar, evil, bad, dreadful thing. So the first condition was not met. لم يصبر. موسى عليه السلام was impatient. Why? Because this is an enormous matter, very problematic. مشكلتها عظيمة. سفينة في البحر, a ship in the sea. He scuttles it to drown it, لتغرق أهلها, so that you know the outcome will be to drown its people. Meaning, إذا خرقتها غرق أهلها. Mean, if you scuttle it, then you know its people will drown. We have no doubt, there is no doubt that Musa عليه السلام لا يدري ما غرض الخضر. He doesn't know the objective of الخضر. موسى عليه السلام doesn't know the objective of الخضر. Yet also on the other hand, he knows أنه لا يريد أن يغرق أهلها. He knows that he doesn't want to drown its people, because if he intended so, then the first who will be drowned will be الخضر and موسى. However, here the lamb in لتغرق in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to لتغرق is the lamb of العاقبة, meaning the outcome would be just like the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning Musa himself with the people of Fir'aun, as in Surah Al-Qasas 28 verse 8, فالتقطه آل فرعون ليكون. This lamb is very important. ليكون لهم عدوا وحزنا. فالتقطه, so then the household of Fir'aun, the Pharaoh, picked Musa up, that he might, look at this, that he might become for them an enemy and a cause of grief. So if one comes and asks a question, هل آل فرعون التقطوه ليكون لهم عدوا وحزنا, did they pick him up so that he, you know, becomes an enemy to them? Is this their objective? No one would say this, but this is as to the outcome. This is what it means. So here he told him, لقد جئت شيئا إمرا, indeed you have committed something very munkar, evil, bad and dreadful thing. يعني, it tells us, كان موسى شديدا قويا في ذات الله. موسى عليه السلام was strong when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فهو أنكر عليه, so he denounced that which came from him, and that he made it clear that his action, the outcome of it will be dreadful. And in this saying, therefore, he strongly denounced him when he said imra. This imra is very munkar, is very evil and bad and dreadful thing. So what happened? Al-Khidr said, verse 72 please, قال ألم أقل إنك لن تستطيع معي الصبر. He Al-Khidr said, did I not tell you that you would not be able to have patience with me? فاعتذر موسى. فاعتذر, so he apologized. In the verse 73, Musa said, apologizing, قال لا تؤاخذني, call me not to account for what I forgot. ولا ترهقني من أمري عسرا and be not hard upon me for my affair with you. And it is why it forgot, because the matter is was in a very intense. You scuttle this ship and the people are on it. This yani made him forget. من شدة ما وقع ذلك, because of the intensity of it on him. And also don't be hard upon me for my affair. As if this, subhanallah, as if this, وكأن هذا والله أعلم توطئة لما يأتي بعده. His statement here, and be not hard upon me for my affair, it is as if it is a prelude to what will come next. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, knows best. We stop here inshallah ta'ala, and we continue next week our discussion, our explanation of Surah Al-Kahf. Al-Kahf, this great surah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make of what was explained today a benefit for myself and for all of you. And wa jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu feekum.